But I want to welcome those who are listening also. And may God bless you. We wish you were here. Oh, I know what it's going to say. Many of the people that tune in on Sabbath mornings for our Sabbath school and for our church service are here now. I don't know if many, but some of you are here. And it's very nice to see you when we see just names pop up. So welcome, everyone. And if I haven't spoken to you, I hope to do that soon. Now, we want to open with Romans 14, starting in verse 1. We're going to skip to verse 10, but verse 1 says, "Him that is weak in the faith receive you, but not to doubtful disputations. For one believeth he may eat all things, another who is weak eateth herbs." Then in verse 10, "But why dost thou judge thy brother? Or why dost thou set at naught thy brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ." Verse 13. "Let us not therefore judge one another any more." 17. "For the kingdom of God is not meat and drink," and I might add drugs. We're going to be talking about drugs. "But righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit." I will be talking today about drugs and talking about it tomorrow. And I know we all have decided ideas about what we should and should not use. But before we get started, let us remember to foster peace and not doubtful disputations. Where we can, let us extend Christian liberty to one another to remember firstly, pardon me, that the kingdom of heaven is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. We will not be opening up the floor to address your health issues or mine, or to address your preferred methods of treatment or mine. The purpose of our study is to consider the times of the 1800s, the drugs used then, the counsel of Ellen White concerning them, and then to make a broad application for today, and if there's time, to discuss the issues we face today with considering drug-resistant diseases and how we address that. I can't be sure we'll have time, but we can do that if there is time. In the process of our study, we will review the herbs and treatments used and recommended by Ellen White. But what we want to focus on, I'm going to repeat that, is what was happening in the 1800s, how Ellen White talked about it, and then hopefully we can make an application to ourselves today. But that will probably be tomorrow. But what I can promise you is that we will have a very interesting study about the diseases, the treatments, the drugs of Ellen White's day. So let's get started with next. Mervyn G. Harding was born and raised in India, and when he was 18 years old, he attended Newbold College in England, majoring in theology and business. After he was graduated, he was employed as an assistant pastor in Sheffield, England, to start on October 1. But just as he was beginning his duties, while walking down a street in Sheffield, he heard a voice speak to him, Brother Christophe, Jean Christophe. He heard a voice, and this voice said, not stand up and go get a Bible. This voice said, "You must take the medical course." Harding was stunned. He wanted to be a minister, and he did his best to silence this command. But on December 25, remember, he started October 1. On December 25, he and his mother had a frank conversation about her and his dad's future. They wanted to leave England. Remember, he was raised in India where it was very warm. In England, it was too cold. and too drafty and too cloudy, and they wanted to leave, and Mervyn was the only single child left. And so she was talking about this with Mervyn, and then he told her about the voice he heard. Her response was, they were moving to California, and he was going to medical school, and she was going to write the school and tell them they were coming. And that's what happened. He eventually received his medical degree from the College of Medical Evangelists in Loma Linda, and then a doctorate in public health from Harvard, and a doctorate in pharmacology from Stanford. He established the School of Public Health at Loma Linda, but not the School of Medicine, but the School of Public Health. Speaking of Ellen White, he wrote, through the years, I have struggled with what her message on therapeutics was really about. Back in 1945, I attempted to resolve the problem by placing her statements on drugs in chronological order, but that did little to help. Finally, I decided that should God spare my life, I would thoroughly investigate the matter after I retired. And this I have done. Next slide. And he put it all together in this particular book, Drugs, Herbs, and Natural Remedies. And that's the foundation of what we're going to talk about today and tomorrow. And so I thought, well, he put them in chronological order. Maybe I can do that too. But there are nearly 600 references in the database alone of the word drugs, plural, not anything else. And so it was just impossible to do for me in the time frame I was working in. But I got started. And the first one that came up in the database is this one, written in 1864. Unsuspecting parents will try the skill of one physician after another who prescribe drugs. Their drugs only add a second great burden for abused nature to struggle against, which often breaks down in her efforts, and the victim dies. We're familiar with that. Next one, 1884. The health retreat was established at a great cost to treat the sick without drugs. It should be conducted on hygienic principles. Drug medication should be worked away from as fast as possible until entirely discarded. Next one, 1890. Drug medication, as it is generally practiced, is a curse. Educate away from drugs, use them less and less, and depend more on hygienic agencies. Then nature will respond to God's physicians. Pure air, pure water, proper exercise, a clear conscience. Drugs need never be used, seldom be used. 1905. It is the Lord's purpose that his method of healing without drugs should be brought into prominence in every large city through our medical institutions. 1905 also. Thousands need and would gladly receive instruction concerning the simple methods of treating the sick, methods that are taking the place of the poisonous drugs. A practice that is laying the foundation of a vast amount of disease and of even more serious evils is the free use of poisonous drugs. When attacked by disease, many will not take the trouble to search out the cause of their illness. We're familiar with all of these, but this is just giving you refreshing in your mind what she has said about drugs. 1905. People need to be taught that drugs do not cure disease. It is true that they sometimes afford present relief and the patient appears to recover as the result of their use. Health is recovered in spite of the drug, but in most cases the drug only changes the form and location of the disease. Often the effect of the poison seems to be overcome for a time, but the results remain in the system and work great harm at some time later next by the use of poisonous drugs. Many bring upon themselves lifelong illness, and many lives are lost that might be saved by the use of natural methods of healing. Many of the popular nostrums called patent medicines, and even some of the drugs dispensed by physicians, act a part in laying the foundation of the liquor habit, the opium habit, the morphine habit, that are so terrible a curse to society. Like Harding, we may also have struggled through the years with what Ellen White has to say about drugs and how to apply that to our lives. Next slide. So, in his book, he addresses, and I have listed here some of the issues that he addresses. The first one is the medical education and practice in Ellen White's day. He also addresses the drugs used in the 1800s and early 1900s, medical reformation. We're going to talk about all of these, how the body functions. Next slide, natural, herbal, and simple remedies. She talks about each one of those. And we will also talk about the remedies she used or she recommended. And then we will close with the question he raises, should drugs ever be used? I want to close this section with this painting. In the early history of our country, people were isolated. They lived out on the frontier, far from neighbors, but the physician was a circuit-riding physician. And the first person on the horse there is the physician coming to a log cabin, and they made their circuit to see if there were any needs in that cabin physically. But along with him came a circuit-riding pastor on the dappled horse. And so the two of them would make their rounds on the early frontier, addressing the physical needs as well as the spiritual needs. And I thought this was a nice portrait. Yes. Because that's what we want to do today. And so now we are going to go to the American frontier. On a peninsula where the James River flows into the Chesapeake Bay, a group of men stepped down from the Susan Constant, from the Discovery, and from the Godspeed, ships that had departed England 5 months earlier. They were city dwellers, not farmers, and they had come to establish a colony. The French, the Spanish, the Portuguese were already doing this in the New World, and England wanted a part. This particular peninsula, however, was swampy and plagued with mosquitoes, and the water on all sides was brackish. After getting settled, building their fort, it was too late to plant crops, and in addition, the area was suffering from a drought. 104 men and boys arrived in 1607, and by 1610, most of them had died. The governor of Jamestown described it this way, and this is the governor of Jamestown writing his report. Our men were destroyed with cruel diseases as swelling, fluxes, burning fevers, and by wars, and some departed suddenly, but for the most part they died of mere famine. Our food was but a small can of barley soaked in water to 5 men a day. Our drink, cold water taken out of the river, which was at flood stage very salty, and at low tide full of slime and filth, which was the destruction of many of our men. Thus we lived for the space of 5 months in this miserable distress, not having 5 able men to man our bulwarks upon any occasion. Our men night and day groaning in every corner of the fort, most pitiful to hear. These men and boys were destroyed with cruel diseases, in addition to the famine. This was 1607. No physician came from England to be part of the Jamestown settlement. In 1620, another group of settlers arrived from the Old World, this time weighing anchor at Cape Cod, and Samuel Fuller was among those who disembarked from the Mayflower. He was the colony's physician and surgeon. Colonial and frontier life in America was carved out of the untamed land. Medical education was non-existent, except for what could be learned through apprenticeship. Settlers did their best to replicate old life in England, and they learned new remedies from the natives. Quinine, for example, for malaria, foxglove for heart issues, and willow bark for fever and pain. But no one understood the cause of disease, and superstition was rampant. Warts were believed cured by applying water collected from a rotting tree stump. Smallpox was treated with the powder of dried toads. And birthmarks were supposedly removed by rubbing the hand of a corpse on them. But eventually frontier life smoothed out. Land was cleared, houses and schools were built, and a federal government was established, which paved the way for railroads and a system of education. And by the 1800s, medical schools had been established. The University of Pennsylvania was the first school of medicine, established in 1765. Next slide. And Harvard School of Medicine was begun in 1782. But illness remained mysterious, and the schools of medicine only perpetuated false knowledge and dangerous treatments. Treating someone with dried toads or water from a rotting tree stump was minor compared to what developed. Poisonous chemicals and potions were introduced in vain attempts to cure disease. They knew no better and were grasping at straws. The physicians only wanted to be healers, but were lost in the darkness of speculation and superstition. And their main approaches to treatment were bloodletting, blistering, and purging, and then the use of so-called drugs. Next slide. Bloodletting always seemed to work. If a patient had a fever, the best way the physician knew to reduce it was with bloodletting. It usually brought a rapid response. Soon after, the patient would become bathed in copious perspiration, and the fever and delirium would be gone. If, however, the first bleed did not accomplish this, a second bleed would be done, and sometimes a third and a fourth. And by this time, the patient was so debilitated that he often died. George Washington is an example. He had a sore throat, a fever, and laborious breathing, most likely something akin to severe tonsillitis or laryngitis. And here is the report, next slide, of his two doctors on that fateful night in 1799. The necessity of bloodletting suggested itself to the general. The doctor didn't tell him. He thought of it. And he procured a bleeder in the neighborhood who took from the arm in the night 12 or 14 ounces of blood. The following day, discovering the case to be highly alarming and foreseeing the fatal tendency of the disease, two consulting physicians were immediately sent for. In the interim were employed two copious bleedings. A blister was applied to the part affected. Two moderate doses of calomel, we'll talk about that later, were given. An injection was administered which operated on the lower intestines, they mean an enema, but all without any perceptible advantage, the respiration becoming still more difficult and distressing. Upon the arrival of the first of the consulting physicians, it was agreed to try the result of another bleeding when about 32 ounces were drawn without the smallest apparent alleviation of the disease. 10 grains of calomel were given, succeeded by repeated doses of emetic tartar amounting in all to 5 or 6 grains, with no other effect than a copious discharge from the bowels. The powers of life seemed now manifestly yielding to the force of the disorder. Blisters were applied to the extremities, together with a cataplasm of bran and vinegar to the throat. Speaking, which was painful from the beginning, now became almost impracticable. Respiration grew more and more contracted and imperfect till he expired without a struggle the same evening. All of us can agree. All of us can agree with Ellen White when she wrote in 1898, "Many physicians in our world are of no benefit to the human family, and that the sick, quote, need not call in a doctor any more than they would call in a lawyer." And you can understand, you would not want to go through what George Washington went through. Malaria was the most prevalent disease in America at this time, in the early 1800s, and not only in the southern regions, but also north into Wisconsin and Minnesota. Wherever there were marshes and bodies of stagnant water, malaria was rampant. And that's hard to believe because we still have marshes and stagnant water, but we're not exposed to that. But in her day, or at least the 1800s, this was very prevalent. One observer made this statement concerning an inn 12 miles south of Chicago. The place seemed to be the headquarters of the mosquito tribe. They kept our hands and handkerchiefs in constant motion, and yet they evaded both, so as to cover the faces of most of the parties with large pustules from their bites. They were the largest and most venomous I had ever seen, and the sultriness of the night, the closeness of the place, and the filth of the room in which we were staying seemed to give them new vigor. I went into the open air, hoping for some relief, but met as large a legion of them without as within, and found there was no escape from their tormenting attacks. One of our western passengers declared that in a part of the prairie from which he had come, they were so thick that if you held out your naked arm straight for a few minutes, so as to allow them to settle on it, they would be followed by such a cloud of others hovering around them that if you suddenly drew in your arm, you would perceive a clear hole in the cloud by the space that the arm had occupied. I don't know what the difference is today, except perhaps spraying, I don't know. And that's a quote from Buckingham. Now, by the way, Buckingham also stated that the flies were so prevalent that at one meal it was impossible to see the food on the dishes because of the swarms of black flies. So, for the most part, our country was young and poor. It had polluted water supplies, unsanitary means of sewage disposal, unhygienic methods of food preparation, and a lack of control over the mosquitoes, flies, and other vectors of illness. Illness was a major part of the lives of Americans at this time, including Ellen White and the believers, the fellow believers. From her diary of just 3 months, the first 3 months of 1859, we find the following excerpts. "We tried to comfort Augusta. She's cast down and discouraged. Health poor and no one to depend on. Sister Bognes is poor and sickly. Gave Agnes a half-worn dress for her mother. They are poor. The husband and father is sick. Rested well last night, but feel depression of spirits this morning. I went to Brother Thompson's, was gladly received, yet did not enjoy the visit was unwell. After supper, I went to Brother Day's. Had quite a good visit, yet do not feel in a visiting mood. My spirits are depressed. Brother Leander had gone hunting. Their little one is not well. This is all in the space of 3 months, her entries. Am quite sick. Went to the meeting, was so sick I was obliged to return home to Brother Leander's. I felt so miserable I could not converse. Why am I so depressed? Why so cast down and homesick? Brother Kramer is a cripple, caused by a fall from a building. I am so weary and lame through riding, I cannot move without suffering pain. Sister Root is in feeble health. Brother Kramer is deeply affected with ill health and lameness. My teeth troubled me through the night. Little Willie seems overjoyed to meet us again. Poor child, he has been very sick in my absence. Is now better, but looks miserable. My husband has been sick. My lungs trouble me very much. Another entry. Health poor. Another entry. My health is very poor. Am troubled with severe cramp in my side. I cannot stand straight and walk with much pain and difficulty. Intended visiting the Brother Dan. It's impossible to go. I feel a strange weakness. Another entry. In the eve at the commencement of the Sabbath, we assembled at Brother T. Meade's to pray for him, that God would heal him of his disease. Did not attend meeting today, which was the Sabbath. My husband was sick. Next entry. I suffer so much pain in my shoulder, lung, and my whole side. Next slide. Thomas Meade is much cast down. His lungs trouble him much. Not able to attend meeting. My teeth troubled me. My health is very poor. I suffer continually in body. I have a sick headache. Quite unwell. So you can see that in 3 months' time, Ellen White and the people she conversed with and visited were troubled with sickness. Sickness was a way of life during the 1800s. Second to malaria in prevalence were diarrhea and dysentery. Dysentery is also known as the flux. Adults died after years of suffering from chronic diarrhea. And this chronic diarrhea, you would think, who dies from diarrhea? Unless it's dysentery or something that's really bad. But this is chronic. And it's because of the lack of sanitation at this time, pardon me, and from intestinal disorders they picked up, often in the form of cholera, and cholera was the leading cause of death in children, and probably the most terrifying of diseases. And here is a physician of the time. He wrote a report of this. It struck the sufferer so rapidly. We don't have cholera. We don't understand the seriousness of it. But it struck the sufferer so rapidly that it was almost a shock. One victim of an attack stated that as he was walking, he felt himself growing stiff from the knees downward. Then, he related, I felt suddenly a rush of blood from my feet upward, and as it rose, my veins grew cold, my blood curdled, my legs and hands were cramped with violent pain. Suddenly, he found himself thrown to the floor as if shot. William McPheeters, a physician who treated physicians in the 1849 St. Louis epidemic, stated that the symptoms were vomiting freely with frequent and copious discharges from the bowels, at first of slight bilious character, but it soon became pure rice water. I'm sorry to be so graphic. Cramps in the stomach, lower extremities, and tongue cold. Skin of a blue color and very much corrugated. Urinary secretion suspended, eyes sunken, surrounded by a livid hue. All this occurred in a few hours while the patient sunk into a corpse-like collapse. Respiratory ailments such as pneumonia, influenza, and pulmonary tuberculosis were also a major cause of disease. Yellow fever was epidemic in the U.S., appearing nearly every year between 1800 and 1879. Thousands of people died from it. The standard treatment for yellow fever was bloodletting, up to 20 ounces, 2 to 4 times a day. Repeatedly, after every exacerbation of fever, this was supplemented with purging, and not the gentle cleansers we have today, but with 8 to 12 grains of calomel, we'll talk about that, but that's mercury, mixed with jalap, a very fierce purgative, or rhubarb, given every 4 to 6 hours. This treatment was later updated to 60 grains of calomel. Patients were also doused with cold seawater until they couldn't stand it any longer. This was for yellow fever. Quinine was also given, but it didn't help yellow fever. And so, hello, Brother Mike, welcome. And so, doubt was cast on quinine as any sufficient treatment for anything, including malaria. Medical information in the 19th century was limited and mainly guesswork. No one understood how disease was transmitted or how to successfully treat it. The only essentials for a medical school were a faculty chosen from local doctors, and any doctor would do, a lecture hall, and a room for dissection, and that's all a medical school needed. Next slide. One must needs have lived in those days, this is a physician writing from the 19th century, and have seen the sick to realize the terrible character of regular medicine. The miserable sinners suffering from disease were tormented continuously by nauseant drugs, by unutterable nausea of the stomach, the torments of the physic, that's the purging, the suffering from blisters, and the terrible thirst from the mercury, which cried to heaven for relief, and it wasn't granted. We'll get to that. The blister was drawn, clipped, poulticed, and not unfrequently stunk so as to be recognized as soon as the door of the house was opened. Patients were unwashed. Clothing and bed clothing allowed to become dirty. Dirt and bad odors, indeed, were characteristic of the treatment. Now let's talk for a minute why treatment always included bloodletting, blistering, and purging. Please remember that the theory of disease at this time, the main theory, I should say, was that there was something bad inside a person that had to be gotten out and in order for healing to take place. So blood was let out. And that was the first phase of treatment. Household members were taught how to bleed one another. This was the first line of attack during George Washington's last illness. No physician first bled him. He called for a neighbor to come over to do that. A veterinarian from a nearby farm. Next slide. The people were also familiar with leeches. I mean, they just did this. It was like taking Tylenol for most of the America today. Bloodletting was the first thing you did if you were sick, and you knew how to do it, or someone nearby knew how to do it. And this lady's putting leeches on herself. It was a normal, everyday treatment. And they were not concerned with how much blood they let out, because in those days, they thought each person had 3 times the amount of blood or more than we actually have. And so until the person went into shock or fainted, they would keep bleeding. Blistering was just what the term says. It causes blisters to form, which were punctured, irritated to make them ooze more, getting that badness out, and then sucked even by a cupping suction method, which of course caused infection, which they didn't understand, and pus requiring more sucking, and soon the patient had a raging infection. Many intestinal cleansers are sold on the market today, and we are much more knowledgeable about the use of herbs in this process. But in the 1800s, strong, harsh, debilitating cathartics were used, highly irritating substances, some of which we know today to be definite carcinogens. In the 1800s, these substances were administered repeatedly and resulted in the obvious work of getting everything out, but in the process, scrubbing the intestines, if you can just think of it, scouring the intestines so that blood, you know, it was the mucosa was broken, and the blood came at this point also. It was a terrible, and it wasn't just once. They kept applying this. Kept applying blisters, but we'll talk more about that. It was a terrible and debilitating process, and the patient often succumbed to it in death or to a long healing process from the combined treatment itself. It was called heroic medicine because, not because the person had to be heroic, that's true, but because the intensity and thoroughness of it. Treatment marched on as a hero to conquer disease with harsh, warlike methods. Now let's talk how the treatment was administered. The bleeding, for example. The same basically today. A tourniquet was applied on the upper arm. An unsterile lancet was used to cut the vein in the elbow area. A bowl was held underneath, and then the stuff was discarded. Blistering could have been anywhere on the body. Patches of mustard or other substances were, and we'll get to some of them, worse than mustard, were applied to the chest, to the back, the thighs, the neck, the abdomen. Sometimes the whole head was shaved and you had a cap of this blistering agent. Remember, they thought they were healing the patient. They were doing something good to get the badness out. While this abysmal work was going on of blistering, strong purgatives were administered. One of the strongly irritating substances used was croton oil, C-R-O-T-O-N, obtained from crushed croton seeds. The oil is a drastic and a very rapid cathartic and one of the most purgative substances known. It can induce vomiting. Also, it raises blisters if it's applied to the skin. Croton oil is considered a carcinogen today, and eating only four seeds, and they're not big seeds, eating only four seeds is lethal to a man, and 15 seeds will kill a horse. When oil was not available, a single kernel was all that was needed to induce purging. The story of George Washington's last illness, next slide, begins on a cold winter day. Then 67-year-old former president rode out to inspect the farm on the periphery of his sprawling Mount Vernon plantation or estate. Under a cold and cloudy sky, the general mounted his trusty steed and headed out about 10 a.m. to mark trees to be removed from the estate. About 3 hours into his tour, the sky opened up and a driving rain began, followed by hail and snow. As Washington pressed onward, the weather deteriorated. An icy December wind began to blow next. By the time he returned to Mount Vernon at 3 p.m., his hair was covered in snow, his neck was soaking wet. He entered Mount Vernon at the west entrance, where he was greeted by his friend and estate manager, Tobias Lear, a New Hampshire native, by the way, who had started working for the Washingtons in 1784. The general went to the dining room where the table was set for two, and Martha joined him. after a warm meal and hot tea and after completing a batch of correspondence, he retired. By the next afternoon, his voice was hoarse, and it was difficult for him to speak. He retired early, but at 2 a.m., awoke with fever and shivering and hard, laborious breathing. He was bled by a neighbor, and the doctor was summoned, who bled him again. In fact, he was bled 4, some say 5, times in total, removing over half, some say 80%, of his blood supply. He was also blistered on the throat with cantharide poultices, we'll get to that one, given doses of calomel and other purges, all for a sore throat, or tonsillitis, or laryngitis. We don't know what was wrong with him. So let's now move to the drugs used. This is the background. So now we're going to talk about the remedies of the 19th century. First slide. Remember, we read not too long ago that the effects of the treatment of early 19th century physicians on the patient are difficult for our mind to comprehend. It's like a whole different world. And the only 19th century, the early 19th century was known as the age of heroic medicine. I didn't make that up. That's what you will find if you study it out. It was called this because of the rigorous treatment, the heroic treatment given to the patient of bloodletting, purging, and blistering. George Washington's heroic treatment consisted in part of repeated bloodletting, calomel, several blisters caused by cantharidin, a substance secreted by some of the blister beetles. It is a potent blistering agent and is classified as an extremely hazardous substance. And this is one of the blister beetles. They would dry them and crush them up. Without us getting involved, the little beetle would encase the egg case, surround the egg case with this blistering substance so that their eggs would last. But this is one of the blister beetles. Next slide, another blister beetle. Cantharidin, that's this crushed blister beetle, is dangerously toxic if ingested. Similar to strychnine, it will cause severe GI bleeding and renal dysfunction and often organ failure and death. If the person doesn't die, permanent renal damage may result. Its effects were discovered in 1810, so it was a relatively new drug on the scene. But 2 centuries ago, it was not used internally unless you happen to be a person inclined to get rid of someone you don't like, because it could very well be fatal. But in the 18th century, it was used externally as a blistering agent. It causes severe chemical burns. Cells of the epidermis break down, releasing fluid, which raises the blisters. The good part is the skin will heal from this without scarring. And so even today, a diluted substance of cantharidin from the blister beetle is used by dermatologists to get rid of warts or even tattoos. But not only do blister beetles produce this cantharidin, so do false blister beetles, cardinal beetles, and soldier beetles. I'm just telling you this in case you happen to like beetles and want to hold them or whatever. You want to be careful, not only of the blister beetles, but these other cardinal, soldier beetles, etc. Cantharidin is classified in the U.S. as an extremely hazardous substance and is subject to strict reporting requirements by facilities which produce, store, or use it in significant quantities. And by the way, mustard gas is also a blistering agent. It's not really a powder, it's little droplets. But when you inhale it, it blisters your lungs. It's a much more wicked substance, mustard gas is. And it's producing it or stockpiling it is banned by the Chemical Weapons Convention. But ISIS and Syria and Iraq don't seem to abide by it. But it's a severely debilitating substance, much worse than cantharidin. Now we're going to move on to aconite. This was another drug prescribed during Ellen White's day. Anyway, a quote from a doctor at this time said, "Of all the drugs we possess, there is certainly none more valuable than aconite. Its virtues by most people are only beginning to be appreciated. Aconite is derived from the tuberous root of the common monk's hood. The leaves also contain it." And I just tell you that in case you happen to go in a garden and you're rummaging around in the plants. If you are with an aconite and your hands are not protected, this toxin can go through your skin. It was prescribed for neuralgias, to control inflammation, such as tonsillitis or sore throat, croup, pneumonia, pleurisy. In actuality, it is a rapidly acting and powerful poison. Toxic levels characteristically produce a numbness in the lips and mouth, then in the fingers, then the heart beats weakly, respiration slow, then stupor or convulsions, and finally death. It's an extremely toxic, but this is what was prescribed. And there was no drug more valuable to at least one of these doctors. It's also known as monk's hood, wolf's bane, leopard's bane, mouse bane, women's bane, I don't know why women's bane, devil's helmet, queen of all poisons, blue rocket. I'm just giving you these names so that you can be a little familiar that this is a toxic plant. The roots are poisonous and have been used in arrow poisons for hunting bear, ibex, in warfare. Alaskans used it on their spears and hunting whales, and it was prescribed to patients in the 1800s. It's a potent neurotoxin. Poisoning can occur through the skin when picking leaves without protection. It has been used in traditional Chinese Indian medicine and by the ancient Greeks and Romans. And here is a picture of the plant. It grows like that, but we'll get a close-up of the blossom, and it does look like a monk's hood. It's called monk's hood. Next picture is of the leaf. Just giving that to you so you'll be a little familiar with it and not pick it freely. Now we want to talk about a purging element, croton oil. Seeds of the croton plant contain one of the most purgative substances, and this was used, brothers and sisters, as a healing substance in Ellen White's day. Croton oil is expressed from the seeds, and taken internally, it's drastic, rapid, gushing, and applied to the skin, it's highly irritant. Here's a picture of the croton plant with the seed pods on it, and then a close-up of it, of the seed pods. It is caustic, produces blisters when applied to the skin, and when taken internally, causes severe cramping and often bloody stool. And often the blisters become infected. Next slide is the ornamental croton. You might see this in yards, and it's a beautiful plant. You won't see it up here because it has to be 60 degrees or higher for it to grow. But I put it there in case someone happens to live in that kind of a climate and goes to a nursery and buys this. It's fine. It can be ornamental, but you just want to make sure your pets don't eat the seeds and that you are careful handling the seeds, because even though this is a different variety than what was used in the 1800s, it's still highly toxic. Now we want to talk about that calomel, C-A-L-O-M-E-L, prescribed over and over and over during Ellen White's day. It's a mercurial compound. Mercury accumulates in the body. Early symptoms of mercury ingestion are purging, that's why they gave it, and salivation. And with repeated doses, and they would give repeated doses if you didn't get better, so to speak. Of course, you were getting worse from it, but they would give repeated doses. Then the gums, the tongue, the salivary glands become inflamed and painful. And then the mouth becomes unusually hot, gums become swollen and red, ulcers appear. This is from Harding's book, and also one of the historical books I have, because I'll give you a quote later in just a minute. But ulcers appear in all directions in the mouth. Saliva becomes thick, tongue swollen and stiff, accompanied by a fever. It destroys every part that it touches if it's in high enough doses, until the lips, the cheeks, and even the bones are eaten away, and then death comes. A slide, please. This is the quote. The teeth, a doctor at this time, so-called doctor at this time, the teeth, he wrote, the teeth become loose and rot, perhaps fall out, or worse still, the upper and lower jaw bones exfoliate and rot out sometimes, as I have witnessed, in the form of horseshoes in your mouth. Parts of the tongue and palate are frequently lost, and the poor object lingers out a doleful existence during life. This is another substance used, and of course you can understand why Ellen White said these poisonous drugs. Call in a lawyer before you call in a physician. Calomel was given to patients as a purgative and was often administered to patients in such great quantities that their hair and teeth fell out. It was prescribed for anything the doctor didn't understand, he was puzzled about, because if taken eternally, it would cause vomiting and purging. So he didn't have to know what was wrong with you, because what needed to be done is to get the stuff inside out. And diagnosis wasn't important, so calomel was given. Question, sir?
You said this was a plant?
No, croton oil was the plant that I showed you. Croton, C-R-O-T-O-N. Now I'm talking about mercury. And it was prescribed in Ellen White's day, not as mercury, but as calomel, C-A-L-O-M-E-L. And it was prescribed almost like we talked about bleeding, like today. Most of America will take a Tylenol or whatever when they're not feeling well. This was prescribed when someone wasn't feeling well either, because it would induce vomiting and purging. Since vomiting and purging were thought to release impurities from the body, it didn't matter if the doctor knew what was wrong or not. He knew calomel would help. In fact, he wasn't considered a good doctor unless he gave it. And remember, calomel is mercury. This is Karen Wetterhahn. She was once a professor of chemistry at Dartmouth College in New Hampshire, specializing in toxic metal substance or exposure. On August 14, 1996, she spilled one or two drops, that's all, of dimethyl mercury from a pipette onto her gloved hand. She was not concerned, as she was observing all the recommended precautions. She had latex gloves on and was wearing a vapor hood. So she proceeded to clean up her counter and her workspace before she took off her the gloves and the hood. As it turned out, she should have stripped those gloves immediately, because tests later revealed that dimethyl mercury rapidly permeates latex gloves and enters the skin within 15 seconds. Her mercury exposure was later confirmed by hair testing, which showed a dramatic jump in mercury levels 17 days later after the accident and peaked 30 days after the accident. But approximately 3 months after the accident, she began suffering brief episodes of abdominal discomfort and significant weight loss. Loss of balance and slurred speech appeared 2 months later. One or two drops of dimethylmercury raised her blood mercury level to 80 times the toxic threshold. Her urinary mercury content was 234 micrograms, normal is 1 to 5. In spite of aggressive chelation therapy, because there's nothing else you can do for mercury poisoning, they try chelation therapy, but in spite of that, her condition deteriorated rapidly. She lapsed into a coma and died less than a year after her exposure. Of course, the mercury used in the 1800s was not dimethyl mercury. That's an extremely potent form of mercury. But all mercury is hazardous to the person. Take, for example, Abraham Lincoln. I don't know if that's a slide or not. Yes. Consider Abraham Lincoln. When did he live? During the 1800s? Yeah. Okay, so let's consider Abraham Lincoln. In a recent study, Norbert Hirschhorn, a medical historian and the lead author of this study on Lincoln, said, "There seems to be clear qualitative changes in his underlying behavior during the 1850s. The gloom becomes impenetrable. He becomes subject to towering rages and outbursts of bizarre behavior, jumping up suddenly, running out of the house for no reason, bursts of inappropriate laughter. Lincoln's rage, leaps to rage, could be terrifying. One contemporary described him as so angry that he looked like Lucifer in an uncontrollable rage. During an 1858 debate with Stephen Douglas, his rival for a seat in the U.S. Senate, Lincoln became so enraged that he grabbed a former aide and shook him till his teeth chattered. But during the Civil War, President Lincoln was known for his steady hand, patience, and wisdom. What made the difference? The authors of this study believe it was the little blue mass pills. Now let me just tell you about the little blue pills. Little blue pills, or blue mass, contained mercury and were sold for whatever ailed you. It could be stroke, worms, childbearing, tuberculosis, toothache, constipation. It was something you could buy to self-medicate with, these little blue pills, blue mass pills. However, he started taking them, and we don't know why he was taking them. I can only assume it was his melancholy, because it was for whatever ailed you, and he started taking them. But because of that, he started suffering rage and bizarre behavior. Slide. Mercury poisoning certainly, the lead author says, certainly could explain Lincoln's known neurological symptoms, insomnia, tremor, rage attacks. A few months after his presidential inauguration in 1861, Lincoln told his good friend John T. Stewart that he had stopped taking the little blue pills, and the reason he stopped was because it made him cross. Now, we know mercury accumulates in the system, but if you stop, if you haven't had extremely toxic levels, your body will eventually eliminate it. And so he stopped taking them, and in a few years he was the stable, patient, wise president that we think of him as. I have the references for those if you need it. Mercury is a naturally occurring element and easily amalgamates with other metals such as gold, silver, and zinc. And just for your information, dental amalgams that use mercury can be 43 to 50% mercury combined with other substances. Mercuric nitrate was used in the felt-making process for hats during the 1800s, and mercury poisoning was prevalent during hatters. You've heard of the Mad Hatter disease? In the 18th and 19th centuries, a lot of men's felt hats were made from hair and rabbit fur. In order to make this fur stick together, it was brushed with mercury. It was extremely toxic, especially if you inhale it. It goes straight to your brain, one person said. And let's see what's next here. The phrase "mad as a hatter" originated in the 1800s because hatters used mercury in making their hats, and they often developed severe mental changes. Mercury passes the blood-brain level, and it also passes the blood-brain barrier, and it also easily passes the placental barrier, and we'll talk about that in a minute. Now, there are three forms. Elemental, which is the liquid, what we consider liquid if you break something and it spreads out, or inorganic and organic form. All of them are toxic. And I just want to briefly talk to you about the organic form. This is Minamata Bay. It's a bay on Japan, the coast, that's right. Up one of the channels of this bay was a chemical plant. And they made acetyl something. I don't know what they made in the 1950s, not too long ago. But, next slide, they used mercury as a catalyst to make their chemical. And the sludge was dumped into the Minamata Bay. And of course, we know better now, it stopped doing it, but back in the 50s and the 60s, I think this is when it took place. And, excuse me, of course the fish, it contaminated the fish and the sea life there in the bay. But around the bay were little villages and fishermen, and they would fish and bring the fish home. It didn't affect the adults as much as it affected the fetuses, because remember, they are very vulnerable and very susceptible to the neurological damage that mercury can do. And the next slide is just a couple of pictures of babies born during this time with severe developmental disabilities, and all because of mercury that the mother obtained by eating the organic form of mercury that was loaded in the fish and the sea life. So that's how toxic mercury is. And mercury was given freely to people during the 1800s. Once the patient was cleaned out and his fever reduced by bloodletting, he was then supposed to be restored to health by the use of tonics. And one of the most prevalent ingredients in the tonics was arsenic. Arsenic. Arsenic is a chemical element. Occurs in many combinations in nature, but it is a highly poisonous chemical. It was cheap, naturally occurring, and was used in England. Remember, pardon me, we are a new country in the 1800s. It just established during the 1700s. We didn't have the manufacturing processes that England had. And in England, arsenic was used in making candles, curtains, wallpaper, and in the fashion industry. All of those industries hadn't been developed here in America, and so we didn't have the problem that England had with arsenic. We could import small enough doses to use in medicines, but not in the way England used it. In Britain, arsenic was used to dye fabric. Bright green. For some reason, arsenic had this quality to dye your what was turned into clothing bright green. It was used in dresses, gloves, shoes, artificial flower wreaths that decorated the fashions, used in the ladies' hair. But it was particularly dangerous for the people who made the clothes, who made the wreaths. For example, in 1861, Matilda, a 19-year-old artificial flower maker whose job was to dust these artificial flowers with green arsenic-laced powder, died a violent death. She convulsed, vomited, foamed at the mouth. Her bile was green. So were her fingernails. The whites of her eyes were green. And an autopsy found arsenic in her stomach, liver, and lungs from this powder. And so it's a very dangerous substance, but it was given as a drug, given for healing here in America at the time of Ellen White. Another one was opium. Highly addictive, causes constipation so that you had to be purged even more, and it made a violent cycle. Cyanide was another drug given to the people during the 1800s. It was given as treatment for asthma, oppressed pulmonary circulation, tuberculosis, bronchitis, pneumonia. It was extremely poisonous, is extremely poisonous, and has no usefulness as a medicinal agent. Harding brings out, there isn't a worse substance you can give someone for asthma because cyanide kills by blocking the cells from getting oxygen, but it was given for asthma. Let's see. Strychnine was also given. That was used for rheumatism, loss of sight, night blindness. It was an extremely poisonous substance, and even in small doses caused death. Another was balsam of Copaiba, which caused violent vomiting, purging, itching, and it was given for diseases of the heart, hemorrhoids, croup, smallpox, anything that they didn't know how to treat. They were just guessing, hoping for the best. Today, the essential oil of balsam of Copaiba is sold still. It's obtained from the trunk of several South American trees, and its usefulness is mixed, the idea. Epicac, you can leave it there. Epicac was another drug freely given to the people in Ellen White's day. It was prescribed for whooping cough, asthma, bronchitis, dysentery. Harding agrees that it's an excellent agent to induce vomiting and is still used today in cases of certain swallowed poisons, but certainly not for whooping cough and bronchitis, etc. So, in summary, these are some of the drugs prescribed during Ellen White's day, and every one of them is toxic and causes untold problems to the person. Even though Epicac is a valuable substance today for certain things, it was given freely during Ellen White's day. And I want to tell you about the traveling medicine man. Not only did the people have to deal with the physicians of the day, there were also traveling medicine men that made their circuits, carrying the little blue pills, rattlesnake oil, liver and kidney pills for whatever ailed you, heart remedies for weak hearts, heroin tablets were given for asthma. Mrs. Winslow's soothing syrup was sold by the traveling salesman to mothers, for babies who were teething. The problem is the main ingredient was morphine. Yeah, morphine. Then there was the Egyptian oil, the vegetable compound for women. Cocaine drops were sold for toothaches, cocaine, lozenges for teachers and orators. Then there was the mixed cancer syrup, the seralgin food for the brain. I'm speeding through this. Laudanum was a mixture sold by the traveling salesman, and laudanum was a mixture of opium and alcohol that you took for sleeping disorders. Now, one physician called opium God's medicine. And, of course, we wouldn't call it that today, but it was so useful for anything that ailed you because it just kind of calmed you down, put you to sleep. I don't know what opium does, but it helped everyone who got it, in a sense, until they became addicted. Then there were the little blue pills that contained the mercury. In addition to the traveling salesman and the physicians of her day, there were also these contraptions that people invented. For example, traveling salesmen would sell electric shoes, electric insoles for your shoes, or magic shoes that would cure sore feet and crippling conditions. Then there was the health jolting chair, and you got in it, it had levers and springs, and it jolted you to exercise the nutritive organs of the body. The age of the traveling medicine man came to an end. But then there were granny remedies. We had the physicians, the traveling salesmen. Then we had all these granny remedies, like mashed snails and earthworms for diphtheria, tea from dried chicken gizzards for stomach ache, tonic. They made a tonic from a half bucket of rusty nails soaked in vinegar for a blood purifier, mold scraped from bread, fried heart of rattlesnake, oil broth, etc., boiled toads. These were the granny remedies that one had to deal with at this time also. So, next slide. The 1800s, you had to deal with the strong drugs of the physicians, the traveling medicine men, and the granny remedies. I want to thank you for your patience.
Amen.
And for sticking with me. Tomorrow we will get into the body, how these agents affect the body, in a sense. We're going to talk about enzymes, honey. And then about how these things apply to us today. But the purpose of today was to give you a background of what her life was like, what the physicians were doing in her day, what the drugs were being prescribed in her day, so that we can understand why she would say they are poison. And so we want to close with prayer. Please. Father, we come to you, the wisest source of everything we need, and we thank you for the spirit of prophecy, for your word, and for Jesus, and we pray that we will understand better these great truths you've given us about health, about why things were said the way they were said. Please help us to understand, and please guide me, I pray. In the following discussion, be with each one as we leave now. Keep us safe and draw us together again for the next meeting, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.